Hello, celebrity gossip enthusiasts. I'm Travis Croden, and you're listening to Us Weekly's Hot Hollywood Podcast. Well, this podcast wouldn't be hot without my two hot lady co-hosts, hot sexy ginger siren, arbiter of style, Miss Gwen Flamberg.
Oh, I'm just over here burning things up, Trav. Hello.
Hello. And the lady who always gets my rose because she is on top of her celebrity news, Sarah Heron.
Hi, Travis. I hope you're doing well.
I sure am. Back at you. And how political of you to ask that. Thank you so much.
I actually didn't ask you. I just said, I hope you are. But yeah, thank you for answering.
Great. Well, there has been a lot of news in the week. There has been breakups and engagements for the most part that I can hardly keep track of who's together, but that is our job and we are going to let you know. And some of this is, you know, because I have a little bit of knowledge about these ladies I know is involved in our woes. Let's start off, Gwen Flamberg. What story made you go, whoa, oh my God, please stop, or whoa, I love it this week?
I was just really mesmerized by this dress and then the after story. I'm talking, of course, about the dress that Kendall Jenner wore to her friend's wedding, Lauren Perez. That was, basically like a bathing suit. Like when I saw the dress, I thought it was a bathing suit. And people on the internet just went crazy. They were totally like, how could you do this? How could you take the attention away from the bride? Like, wow, you're really trying to like be out there. And, you know, the bride, her friend, was like, oh, you looked amazing. Get it. Like, I loved having you at my wedding wearing that dress. So I was just kind of like floored by the whole thing. First of all, even that, like, now wedding guests have wardrobe changes. Like, it used to be that the bride just wore one fabulous wedding dress. Now brides do wardrobe changes, and that has trickled down to, if you are a fabulous guest, you also will wear your very sedate bridesmaid's dress for the ceremony and then change into something that is showing more skin than not skin.
I mean, this dress is ridiculous to wear to someone's wedding.
First of all, it's a ridiculous dress to wear anywhere except the beach or like a pool party. It's basically like sets of postage stamps. I don't understand it. But the whole story made me go, whoa.
I guess it's what you get if you invite a Kardashian Jenner to your wedding. Like, you have to know they're going to upstage you, but you're also going to get to be on Us Weekly's Hot Hollywood podcast. So it's just like the price you pay, you know, a cross to bear, if you will.
Exactly.
The amount of skin showing didn't really upset me about this dress. It was just like how in your face it was. And like, look at me, look at me, look at me.
It's ugly. Sorry.
It looks pretty good on Kendall Jenner. Exactly. And it looks good on Kendall.
What doesn't look good on Kendall?
And by the way, guys, the dress was by Mono. And if you haven't seen it, you know what to do. Go to usmagazine.com/stylish and check it out.
Well, please do check it out because it is quite the dress. Sir Huron, I'm getting a reading like Miss Cleo from the early 2000s. Please tell me of your woe of the week, even though I know what is going to make you go woe.
I mean, guys, what a start to 2022, can I just say? And I feel like 2021 was similar. Actually, we were dealing with a Kalaria Baldwin. There was a lot of stuff going on and the celebrities are continuing the trend that they're just going to like dump all this news on us. There's going to be heartbreaks. There's going to be engagements. There's going to be a lot going on in January and probably through the whole year. But of course, a couple that I have spoken about at length since their conception, if you will, on the podcast and in my everyday life, Machine Gun Kelly, real name Colson Baker, if you didn't know. He put a ring on it. Yes. He put a ring on it with two stones, one diamond, one emerald. He proposed to Megan Fox in traditional fashion. These captions are absolutely out of control, and I would like to read them to you.
Please.
Machine Gun Kelly, my bloody Valentine, if you will. He wrote, quote, "Yes, in this life and every life. Beneath the same branches we fell in love under, I brought her back to ask her to marry me. I know tradition is one ring, but I designed it with Stephen Webster to be two. The emerald, her birthstone, and the diamond, my birthstone, set on two magnetic bands of thorns that draw together as two halves of the same soul, forming the obscure heart that is our love. I mean, beautiful, beautifully said, MGK. And then, of course, Megan Fox, not to be outdone by her man, who looks like a referee or a Foot Locker employee, as well as Adams put it, while he got down on one knee, wrote, In July of 2020, we sat under this tree. We asked for magic. We were oblivious to the pain we would face together in such a short, frantic period of time, unaware of the work and sacrifices the relationship would require from us, but intoxicated off the love and the karma. I wonder what hardships they went through. Like, I guess COVID, or did something else happen? We don't really know. Anyway, somehow, a year and a half later, having walked through hell together, hell, they say, and having laughed more than I have ever imagined possible, he asked me to marry him. And just as in every lifetime before this one, as in every lifetime that will follow it, I said yes. And then we drank each other's blood.
I mean, the blood thing was a bit much. I was just surprised that there was no mention of weed.
I am weed.
I am me too. Weed. I am weed for life.
I think it was Vulture, so I want to give credit where credit's due, but I saw like their lead on the story was like, from I am weed to I am wed. And I was like,
that's a good one.
That I could never. Like, I'm jealous.
That's Wordle. That's like Wordle, oh, MGK, Wordle. Megan Fox style.
So, I mean, it's just funny because this is, you know, classic, these two. Her divorce from Brian Austin Green is not finalized as far as we know. We have the court documents from last month when they got rejected because they had like errors on it. So I guess they filled out the paperwork wrong. But she's got to get that sorted out before she walks down the aisle. I have two questions for you guys. One, did they actually drink each other's blood? I'm sure they did. And two,
yes.
Whose wedding is going to be crazier, Kravis or these blood suckers?
I almost wish they'd have a double wedding. I mean, that would be a show that would get, like, it would break the interwebs. It would get the most tune in of any show.
Throw
ever.
Pete and Kim in there too. Really, just get these couples down the aisle. Mm.
Just get them in there. They absolutely drank each other's blood. I'm sure it was in goblets. There is no doubt about it. And I think that their wedding is going to be definitely a little bit wackier than Kravis's wedding, just because. I mean, they're doing the most. They drank each other's blood. Kravis, what, how do you get flowers on the beach? Groundbreaking. There's no bodily fluids in there at all. So I'm going to give the crown to them. Well, the story that made me go, whoa, this week is such a sad breakup. Jason Momoa and Lisa Bonet have broken up. And I don't know why I was so obsessed with them as a couple. I thought they were just so beautiful together and just like cover of a romance like novel, but make it Brooklyn and like, super, super cool. I just thought that they like had such true love. And they, even though we didn't really know a lot about their relationship just through photos, I sort of fell in love with them. And I was so sad to see that this couple is called it off after 4 years together.
Well,
which
16
I was
surprised years together, 4 years of marriage.
4 years of marriage, 16 years together.
Yeah.
I cannot believe it. Were you guys as shocked as I was? Because they seem so happy. He seems so nice.
I was super shocked and super bereft. And I think that they are happy, but they just don't want the commitment of marriage anymore. I thought that his post announcing their split was beautifully done. I think that, you know, it takes conscious uncoupling to a new level. And, you know, I've always thought that she has to be the coolest chick in the universe, because to be with Lenny Kravitz and then to be with Jason Momoa, and they just both seem to be such incredible relationships and also such loving and meaningful breakups. Yeah. I don't know. You know, I really liked that he referenced in that post that kind of like everybody has been through it these last few years with the pandemic, and that it's been eye-opening for all couples. And I feel like it's just really real and really relatable. And it kind of breaks my heart, but I really respect them.
I don't have like emotional ties to these two. I was surprised because I hadn't really thought about them in a minute, which I guess is when you should, you know, start thinking about these couples when they're not, you know, in our faces. And obviously the pandemic made it where they weren't maybe doing as many outings, whatever. But these divorce announcements are really just like, everyone is trying to one up each other. Like, the love between us carries on evolving in ways and wishes to be known and lived. We free each other to become who we are learning to become. Like, that's very, Kate Bosworth, we are more in love than ever. as we announce our divorce breakup to me. Like, I feel like everyone is just trying to come up with new ways to like avoid the words split and divorce in headlines or something. But like, we can read between the lines. Like, you, it's over. Like, I don't really get this poetic. It's fun to talk about and to digest, but it's like a little much for me personally, but like, Godspeed.
It is. And I feel like when people decide they break up, they're like, and also let us craft this message together. Yeah. Are we going to go poem? Is it going to be a single sentence? It's a little culty. It's a little culty.
By the way, breaking royal family news.
Please share it with us, Sarah. It.
The Queen has released a statement regarding the Duke of York, aka Prince Andrew. With the Queen's approval and agreement, the Duke of York's military affiliations and royal patronage have been returned to the Queen. The Duke of York will continue not to undertake any public duties and is defending this case as a private citizen. So he is no longer the Duke of York, I guess. Is that what that means?
That's right. And also his military accolades, which, you know, were many. If you watch The Crown, you may think that he was Queen Elizabeth's favorite child. And apparently no more. Apparently no more. But I really do like that she took swift action here to denounce, you know, there's just no way around this.
Well,
it's been years.
No, but it's been exactly. But now it's kind of like it's irrefutable by court. Now. And so, you know, it's like immediately she's like, that's it. It's over.
Yeah, I'm taking my accolades away from her because my problem with it was that it was so unswift and that this has been going on for years and there was deafening silence in the royal family, which is something that people, you know, have criticized them for about not being current and sort of being the most uptight family secrets, sort of like what's wrong with families thing. And I think this is like the last possible moment that she could do it right when he's going to trial. It sort of feels like a little bit of a cop out for me where she's like, okay, he's going down. I should probably put it on the record now.
They did try to avoid this as long as possible. For people who don't know, obviously Prince Andrew has been accused of sexual assault and some crazy things with the Jeffrey Epstein of it all. And just yesterday, his trial is moving forward because a judge dismissed his request to throw out the lawsuit. And he could be on trial by the end of the year. And now he's got to be paying for his own lawyers, I guess, because the royal family said, got to go. I just feel bad for Princess Beatrice and Eugenie, obviously. But more importantly, I feel bad for, you know, Prince Andrew's alleged victims.
Of course.
So wild.
Wild. And his alleged victims were all like very, very young. The girls in question, they're all Jeffrey Epstein is and his accusers. But like, horrible. Well, we will keep you updated on this horrible news. I am glad that it is on record that his accolades have been taken away because very deserved. Well, we got to go into some more sad news because it is the news of the week. And Sarah, your gentle voice will calm us during this time when America's dad, Bob Saget, has sadly passed away at 65 years old. At the Ritz-Carlton in Florida, Sarah, tell us a little bit about the cast reactions, the reactions from you, any type of stuff that you want to bring up about this really, really tragic, sad story.
Yeah, this is obviously a sad one. Bob Saget, he was 65 years old and he performed stand-up just Saturday night, hours before he was found unresponsive in his hotel room in Florida. Just seemed like one of those people who was always working. Definitely like we didn't know anything health wise. We still don't really know how exactly this happened. Most reports are suggesting he died in his sleep. He just never woke up. There will be an autopsy done. So we'll probably find out more information, moving forward, but super sad. And I mean, it's just one of those people that the stories that come out, obviously, you know, Bob Saget, a Full House, Danny Tanner. And then he was also known for having like a super dirty stand up, which was ironic because he's Danny Tanner. But everything people are saying from your John Mayer's, his best friend, to the cast of Full House, to people who met him or worked with him once or twice, is just like nicest guy ever. Ended every conversation with, I love you. Loved his wife, Kelly, loved his three daughters. And I haven't read one bad thing about Bob Saget ever, let alone in this past week. So super upsetting. Obviously you have Candace Cameron Bure, John Stamos, Jody Sweetin. They've all been gathered at Kelly and John's house. John Mayer and Jeff Ross just went and picked up Bob Saget's car from LAX because he was traveling for stand-up, and they did an Instagram live on their way home in his Prius. John Mayer was like crying on and off, but they were also joking. Like it was really interesting and really, and honestly, it was sad, but also funny, which is, I think, what Bob would wanted, what they were saying. And they revealed in that, which I thought was interesting, that they have been at Kelly's house too. And they were joking, like, you know, it's been a full house with the cast of Full House. Like, just imagine all of them hanging out, telling stories about Bob. Like, that's just like, so it's so sad. And, but it's so cool that he like brought all of these people together, and they all just have such lovely things to say and probably hilarious stories to share. So yeah, the tributes on Instagram have been amazing. There's like a bunch of them you can go read, and they all kind of have the same message of like, super funny guy, super considerate. I thought it was interesting. Candace Cambray made a point to be like, Bob, you know, he would tell me to watch something, and then he'd be like, okay, actually don't, you're not going to like it. Like, he like respected her like conservative Christian values, while also like they had such a close relationship. So that's also just like a nice message in general, like two very different people, TV dad get along. We got a statement from the Olsen twins, which was thrilling. Sad.
The Jimmy Kimmel tribute was just, I cried. Like, there was no way to listen to it and not feel it. And gosh, it's just so sad on one hand, but also so beautiful that here's this person that just touched so many lives and in such a uniquely positive way. It'll be it's a real loss.
Yeah,
it is. And Sarah, you're right. Every single person who interacted with him was just like, yes, he was the best person ever. And so funny and raunchy, but considerate. So it is really, really a tragic moment for us.
On a personal note, I would just like this on record in recording somewhere that I was watching season one of The Morning Show when Kobe Bryant suddenly died on a Sunday. And just this past Sunday, when I got the TMZ notification, I was watching the season two finale of The Morning Show. So season three of The Morning Show was picked up this week as well. And when it comes out, everyone should be aware that the day I'm watching the finale, unfortunately, we might lose a national treasure, because that's weird, right? The Sundays that were supposed to be award show days with Kobe at Extras, the Grammys, this was the canceled SAGs or whatever, or Globes, and both me watching The Morning Show. Like, am I a witch? I don't know.
I think you might be a witch.
I absolutely think you are. I would be very careful with maybe just read the recap of the season three finale and save era. Maybe think really about like celebrities' show, lives. Yeah, really like I do too. But people also enjoy living. So, well, let's get some levity up in here. Let's talk about Julia Fox and Kanye West, because I have a feeling that these two are going to go the distance. And I would like to do a sink or ship relationship timeline with Julia Fox and Kanye, because I think that they're going to go on for like at least like a year or two. And I sort of believe in this couple. Gwen Flamberg, what are your thoughts? Yes.
I'm really into it, just because I like that it's someone who's like off the beaten path. I don't agree necessarily, Trav, that it's going to go on for a year or two. I do think it's definitely going to go on for a couple of months. But, you know, she evidently was a bit of a super fan. I think that this whole timeline of like them meeting right before New Year's and then coming back to New York and going on a date, like it's all very suspect and interesting. But this, you know, he like invited her on a date and then had a suite full of designer clothes for her to try on. Like, come on, that is a dream. And then during their date, he had someone come and shave his beard. Like, what sort of weird things are happening between these two? I don't really get it, but I'm kind of really into it.
See, like, the fact that Julia Fox is even okay with half of this makes me believe that she's going to be okay with all of it, which is why I see a little bit of longevity. And the fact that he brought all of those clothes to the hotel that they were both staying at reminds me of when he threw out 90% of Kim's closet and replaced it with her new earth tones, and she was okay with that. So I think that if Kanye finds somebody who's fine with this, like, actual insanity that's going on, we have a lasting relationship and possibly true love. Well, but Sarah, listen, I have a feeling you're going to disagree.
He was with Kim, where like she was several notches above him in terms of like popularity of the public. We're not talking about as artists, blah, blah, blah. And now he's with someone who he is echelons above in terms of popularity. She's a critical actress. I loved her in Uncut Gems, but like,
me too.
Let's be honest, nobody really knows who she is at this point. This is kind of catapulting her into the spotlight, but he's the one who kind of has the quote upper hand. Sarah, what are your thoughts?
I mean, this relationship is such a joke. It's not even funny. Like, we're getting an interview magazine piece within 1 week of all the like the photos that you took in the restaurant. Have you guys seen the TikTok of, because she talks about how everyone was staring at them and how it was such an amazing moment. The TikTok of all the people in the restaurant being like, what the fuck are you doing? Excuse my French.
Yes.
She's wearing like a thong, like she's a cast of Euphoria over with her jeans. Kanye is dressing her. I mean, in my opinion, he's just using her because Kim and Pete are like, the craziest thing about this, okay, this Kim and Pete are just spotted at pizza restaurants and movie theaters and drinking Diet Coke and eating ice cream. Like, they are doing the least. They're being normal. Like, it literally just shows that Kim cry for help, like, wants some normalcy in her life. Like, of course the TMZ is going to be there and she's going to be paparazzied. She's still Kim. She's still playing the game. But like, I honestly think that this shows that Kim was just desperate to be like a normal human for a second and like not have a relationship where he's controlling everything you're wearing and everything has to be like Kim Ye and all this pressure. Like, it's just blowing my mind that they're at a pizza place and then these two are having full-on photo shoots and these Cinderella type dates after 11 days of knowing each other. Now we're on day 11. We know every single thing these two people have ever done and they've known each other for 12 days. It's insane. I think he's pissed that Kim and Pete are getting so much attention and this is his way of taking it back. And he does that Kanye thing. He always dresses them. They're his quote unquote muse. And for Julia Fox, like, part of me is like, get it, girl. Like, I didn't know who you were. I have not seen Uncut Gems. I had no idea you existed. So like, happy for you. But at the same time, like, kind of pathetic for you to even want to date this guy after he is publicly saying he would do anything to get Kim back. And it comes off so like ridiculous. So maybe they do have this quote unquote connection that she's talking about. But I personally think it's ridiculous and I give them until the end of February.
Well, it might be moving a little quickly because we have some breaking news with Kanye West. He has been named as an alleged subject, reports TMZ. At 3 a.m. on Wednesday night, Thursday morning, he was in downtown L.A. at the Soho Warehouse. He allegedly pushed someone. The case is being investigated as a misdemeanor battery. They've obtained video that Kanye shot Wednesday night that he seemed really angry. And you can hear Kanye, did y'all say that or not? Did y'all say that or not? Because that's what happened right effing now. So it seems like he was possibly being yelled at by a paparazzi and provoked and shoved someone. But, you know, if it's more than that, we'll be back to talk about it next week.
I mean, this is Kanye. Who are we kidding here? This is a guy who has struggled and been open about his mental health struggles and issues in the past. We've seen him have some, you know, not take it well that this Kim with this divorce, like he's said that basically now he's apparently getting in fights with this. And, you know, I'm sure his girlfriend of 11 days was by his side. Like, this is just like not going to end well. Like, I'm sorry. It's just not like Julia Fox. If you know what you're doing, like now we know who you are. Get out now. Like, go, like stop doing episodes of your podcast that I didn't know existed talking about how you have this connection and it's denying it's a PR stunt. Like, no, get out.
I disagree, Julia. I think you should stay right there. You guys seem really good for each other. Thank you to Sarah and Gwen for helping me spill all of this actually piping hot celebrity ouch it burns this week. Again, this is Travis Cronin, Us Weekly's Hot Hollywood. Again, this is Travis Cronin, Us Weekly's Hot Hollywood podcast with your weekly peek into the glamour, glitter, fashion, fame of your favorite celebrities. Because after all,
they're just like us.
Thanks, guys. We'll be back next week.